Years ago, I had the opportunity to lead worship for an addiction support group. In the moment, I felt a bit small, so I asked my friend if my leading worship had any value to people struggling through so much. His answer surprised me. He said, "You know, when I came to Christ, I gave up drugs. I also had to give up my music because it led me back to drugs. But when I heard you leading worship for the first time, I realized that God wasn't just taking things out of my life, but replacing them with things that were even better." And that's kind of the heart behind Ephesians 5. Paul isn't simply telling you not to do certain things. He's replacing things of darkness with things of light. He says to be filled with love for others. Then there's no room for sexual immorality, impure thoughts, or greed. He says, fill your mind and heart with thankfulness. Then there's no room for harmful words or hurtful jokes. He said, don't overindulge in substances. Instead, be filled with the Holy Spirit. But what does that look like? Worship. Worship in song. That's exactly what it says in verse 19. And finally, he wants to replace your broken marriage with one of peace, order, and love, one that shines like a light in the darkness. The husband is asked to sacrifice his life for his wife, to give her equal standing in his heart as himself, and the wife to sacrifice her will and to respect her husband as a spiritual leader. Verse 32 explains a godly marriage this way. This is a great mystery. Now that word mystery here means a holy vow to act in a way that goes against our nature or flesh. This is a great mystery, but it is an illustration of the way Christ and the church are one. So again I say, each man must love his wife as he loves himself, and the wife must respect her husband.